Welcome to the new journey to paradise. This is part 15. And today we are talking about special number 8 and the 8th day of the assembly. But before we start, we are on our way to Mount Zion. We are walking in the wilderness. We are already a huge multitude. And we are starting to be clothed in white because we have, our sins was forgiven in the blood of Jesus. And now we are clothed in white and we are walking towards Mount Zion, the dwelling place of the Father. And you can be part of this by joining Triple Grace, by establishing a society of the Rose in your neighborhood, or by joining one. Just walk with us on the path towards the throne of glory of the Father, because at Mount Zion, we will be raptured into paradise. And we will be with the Father and the only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, forever and ever. So walk with us on the journey, join us, take our hand, and step out from the world and from Babylon onto the new path. The door is wide open. Join us. Please subscribe, like the videos, click the bell icon to get the notification for a new one, and share the videos with your friends and family. So today our topic is 5779 or 2019, an open door, and the 8th day of assembly. Number 8 and the 8th day of assembly. We are moving from physical to spiritual. The mystery of Shemini. No, let me start again. The mystery of Shemini Atharet. This is the 8th day. What is the real true meaning of the one day festival that occurs at the close of the Feast of Tabernacles, called Shemini Atharet in Hebrew, or the 8th day? Now, before I continue, let me explain. This is not just bound to the Feast of Tabernacles. We have several 8th days. Also, they are not maybe celebrated now by the Jews. They are still 8th day. We have it at Passover. We have it at the second Passover. We will have it around Pentecost. We will have it when a boy is born on the 8th day. There will be the circumcision and many other 8th days related to festivals that the Lord has set for us. The awesome significance of this final festival day in God's plan has gone unnoticed, misinterpreted, and misunderstood by millions. It does not picture the great white throne judgment at the close of the millennium, as thousands have assumed, but something far greater than that. Here the truth is made plain, and this is an article given by William F. Duncanbring. In the book of Leviticus, we read a description of all the annual holy days of God. Sorry, I have to take some coffee. Beginning with Passover, Feast of Unleavened Bread. Pentecost, Trumpets, the Day of Atonement, and the 7-day Feast of Tabernacles, or Ingathering of the Harvest. Leviticus 23, verse 1-36. Then at the close of the Feast of Sukkot, or Tabernacles, in the fall we read, "On the 8th day shall be an holy convocation unto you, and you shall offer an offering made by fire unto the Lord. It is a solemn assembly, and you shall do not servile work therein." That's in Leviticus 23, verse 36. This one-day festival occurs right at the end of the 7-day Feast of Tabernacles, which pictures the millennial reign of Christ. The last or 7th day of the Feast of Tabernacles pictures the final day of harvest or ingathering. That is the final time of spiritual harvest, which is pictured by the great white throne judgment, when all those who ever lived are resurrected and judged according to their works. This 7th day of the feast is also called the great day of the feast. John 7:37. and in the time when God's Spirit is poured out on all mankind, John 7:37-39. It pictures a truly great day of salvation, when billions will be saved and will come to know God. Since the seventh day of the Feast of Tabernacles completes the harvest festival of the great fall harvest, and therefore represents the final day of harvesting and ingathering, the completion of the salvation process and God's plan with mankind. What is the meaning and purpose of the one-day festival that appears to be tacked onto the end of the Feast of Tabernacles? What is the hidden, unrealized meaning of Shemini Azeret and the eighth day? Now, let me explain something. As you can read from this article, it says this is the final harvest. And that's absolutely true. Because what many people do not realize is that we have actually three raptures. We have the first one that I'm not calling a rapture because it is more an escape. And this is the escape of the bride, and it's also clear who is the bride. There's no discussion about that. It is not the church. It is only a part of the church, and that is the Church of Philadelphia. This is a bride, and the bride will escape into third heaven. And also clear when you read the Revelation is that this bride will not return for the Millennium Kingdom. Whoever claims this is a false teaching. This bride will remain in the house of the Father and will come down with the Father at the time when New Jerusalem will come down after the Millennium Kingdom and not before. The people who will return with Jesus to rule the nation with a rod of iron are the church and the rapture, and the second rapture at Mount Zion. And that is a real rapture, because we will be raptured into paradise. And there we will stay with the Lord, and from there we will then come back for the millennium reign, and will reign with the Lord for the 1,000 years. And the third rapture, this is now what is talking about here in this article about the final rapture. This is now about the Jews and the left behind at this time period, and this one so that everybody will see the glory of Jesus just before the millennium reign starts. So let us continue on this article. Shemini Azeret in Jewish law. Before seeing what the scriptures tell us about the subject, let's review briefly the teachings and concepts which rabbinical Judaism has put forth concerning this ancient festival. The Jews have been observing this day along with all God's festivals for the past 3,500 years, since the time of Moses. Therefore, their insights out to be instructive and meaningful. To understand the full meaning of this final holy day, it will help us to compare and to contrast it with the festival that precedes it, the Feast of Tabernacle. As the Jewish Book of Y explains, Shemini Azeret and Shimshat Torah, the rejoicing of the law, are holidays totally independent of the Sukkot holiday. In Israel, as dictated by the Bible, Sukkot is observed for 7 days. This first day is a full holy day, on which one is to abstain from work. The next 5 days are Shol Hamoed, intermediary days, which are considered half holidays. The seventh and last day of Sukkot is Hoshana Rabbah, also a half holiday. The day after Hoshana Rabbah is a separate holiday called Shemini Azeret. Shimshat Torah is not observed as a separate holiday. It is observed as part of Shemini Azeret. The seventh and last day of Sukkot was endowed with special sanctity by the last of the prophets Haggai, Zechariah, and Malachi. Coming at the beginning of the rainy season, it became known as a day of judgment for rain. A special service for rain became part of Shemini Azeret, held on the next day. This Jewish authority goes on to explain further. Germany Atheret, the eighth day of solemn assembly, is often thought of as the eighth day of Sukkot. Actually, it is an independent holiday. The rabbis refer to it as Regel Binyan Yatzmo, a separate holiday, and require that the Shehyanu prayer be recited when the candles are lighted and when the Kiddush is recited. This would not be required if Shemini Atzeret was not an independent holiday. Shemini Atzeret is a one-day holiday marking the conclusion of the festivities and observance of Sukkot, and none of the Sukkot ceremonials apply to it. Further enlightenment concerning the Holy Day of God is provided in the book The Jewish Way, Living the Holidays by Rabbi Irving Greenberg. He relates, when the 7 days of Sukkot end, the Bible decrees yet another holiday, the eighth day of assembly. The rabbis interpreted this as an anchor. After the high holy days, after the intense 7 days of Sukkot and pilgrimage, the Jewish people, or we should say more accurately, God's people, are about to leave, to scatter and return to their homes. God grows nostalgic, as it were, and pensive. The people of Israel will not come together again in such numbers until Passover 6 months hence. God will soon miss the sounds of music and pleasure and the unity of the people. The Torah decreed, therefore, an eighth day of assembly, a final feast holy day. On this day, Jews leave the Sukkah to resume enjoying the comfort of solid, well-built, well-insulated homes. The lulav and etrog are put aside. This day, Shemini Atzeret, is a reprise of the celebration of Sukkot, but without any of the rituals. The message is that all the rituals and symbolic languages are important, but ultimately they remain just symbols. And why am I explaining this to you now? Because I am called to bring together the assemblies and to gather the people and to assemble the elders into the societies of the Rose. We are something like that is so clear, a pattern of what is the eighth day. And this eighth day is now just before the millennium. And now the time has come to build these assemblies of love and righteousness into the nations. And it has everything to do with the eighth day. Everything to do with this one to become more and more holy. As in the eighth day, a newborn boy, Jewish boy, will be circumcised. And the eighth day is the time for us now to become more and more holy, to become more and more as Jesus was, and to bring forth the love of the Father into the nation, and to lift up the needy in His name and His name alone. So let's continue. Shemini Atzeret and the prayer for rain. In the book Celebrate, the Complete Jewish Holidays Handbook, Leslie Koppelman explains more about the eighth day, or Shemini Atzeret. Not only is the feast distinctly different from Sukkot, but it is included a very special prayer for rain. We read as follows. Just as Sukkot gives us a transitional period between the days of Av and our normal routines, the last day of the festival, Shemini Atzeret, or the eighth day of solemn assembly, the day we are held back to extend the party with God, eases us out of the transience of Sukkah. As a separate holiday in its own right, also referred to as Shemini Karg. Atzeret, the eighth day, is honored with the lighting of candles and reciting the festival Kiddush. A prayer for rain? Yes, of course. Are we not told that we'll receive the former and the latter rain? Are we not called into this special period now, when the days of off have finished, and now we will go into the millennium? There's a period in between there, and this we have to fill. This is our time now to call the assemblies and the elders and to bring it forth into the nation. The distinct feature of the day is recitation of the prayer for rain, so that the earth will be able to produce in the coming year. It is not said earlier during Sukkot, which marks the beginning of the rainy season in Israel, because we do not want rain to prevent us from dwelling in the Sukkah or to interfere with our enjoyment of doing so. Rain, of course, is made up of water descending from the skies. It is a type of the Holy Spirit of God. Hear, people. It's a type of the Holy Spirit of God. Comparing God's Spirit to rain, the prophet Joel writes, "And it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my Spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams, and your young men shall see visions. And also upon the servants and upon the handmaids, in those days will I pour out my Spirit." Joel 2:28-29. And are we not saying that we are the Joel 2 army? Everything is coming together, and everything is coming together for the glory of the Father. Water is itself a symbol of life, and is the foundation of all carbon-based life form on Earth. We could not live without it. In fact, water forms about 80% of our physical human bodies. Water and the prayer for rain is a vital ingredient in the celebration of Shemini Atharet. It represents God's Holy Spirit in a very special way. David prayed, "As a hart panted after the water brook, so panted my heart after you, O God. My soul thirsted for God, for the living God, when I shall come and appear before God." Psalm 42:1-2. Isaiah the prophet wrote, "Oh, everyone that thirsted, come you to the waters, and he that had no money, come you, buy and eat. Yeah, come, buy wine and milk without money and without price." Isaiah 55:1. God also compares his word to the rain that waters the earth. In the same chapter, he tells us, "For the rain cometh down, and the snow from heaven, and returneth not thither, but watereth the earth, and maketh it bring forth, and bud, and it may give seed to the sower, and bread to the eater. So shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth, and it shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the things whereto I send it. For you shall go out with joy, and be led forth with peace. The mountains and the hills shall break forth before you into singing, and all the trees of the field shall clap their hands. Instead of the thorn shall come up the fig tree, and instead of the briar shall come up the myrtle tree, and it shall be to the Lord for a name, for an everlasting sign that shall not ever be cut off." Isaiah 55:10-13. And here you read it again. "It shall be to the Lord for a name, in the name of Yahweh, in the name of Yahuwah, the Messiah, Yeshua HaMashiach," or Jesus the Christ in English, offers each one of us living water, John 4:10. The water that leads to eternal life. He said to the Samaritan woman at the well at Sychar in Samaria, "But whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst, but the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life." John 4:14. This is the very water that Isaiah the prophet foretold when he declared, "Behold, God is my salvation, Yeshua. Hebrew Yeshua, I will trust and not be afraid, for the Lord Jehovah. Yahweh is my strength and my song. He also is become my salvation. Therefore my joy shall you draw water out of the wells of salvation. And in that day shall you say, praise the Lord, call upon his name, declare his doings among the people, make mention that his name is exalted. Sing unto the Lord, for he hath done excellent things. This is known in all the earth. Cry out and shout, you inhabitant of Zion. There we have Mount Zion again, for great is the Holy One of Israel in the midst of you. Isaiah 12:2-6. God also prophesied through Isaiah, his prophet, for I will pour water upon him that is thirsty, and floods upon the dry ground. I will pour my spirit upon the seed, and my blessing upon your offsprings. Isaiah 44:3. Yeshua, Jesus Christ, put it this way, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. He that believeth in me is as the Spirit had said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. But this speak he of the Spirit, which ye that believe on him should receive. For the Holy Spirit was not yet given, because that Jesus was not yet glorified. John 7:37-38. The seam of water is intimately tied up with the final day of the year, Shemini Azeret. Now, let me continue with this series in part 16, because it's getting long. You can read all of it on our website at Triple Grace. Please sign up for Triple Grace. Join the discussion. Ask your question at triplegrace55@gmail.com. Help that everything will come for us. Let us go forward into the nations. Please excuse the noise. Join and subscribe especially to Triple Grace, because many people only sign up for the newsletters, but they do not sign up for the membership, and everything is free. So please join us, and I will continue with the second part of the eighth day in part 16. That will come up shortly. I thank you that you are here with me. And please, if you are guided by the Holy Spirit, to help us to bring forth new societies of the Rose and to gather the people and to help Lazarus at the gate and to lift up the needy, the nameless and faceless, then please send your donations to the links in the description box below. We always need help, because we are operating in the whole world, into all the nations. And some continents need more help than the others. But you can be part of it by creating your own societies of the Rose and by working with us together. And I thank you that you were here with me. May God bless you and your family abundantly. My name is Michael, and I wish you a happy day. And I will see you next time. Maranatha.